This morning, it's my great pleasure to welcome Anina and Morgan. Morgan Hendricks is joining us this morning. She's been quite involved with the Whale Coast Conservation Group, particularly with the Chameleon Project. I want to ask her and Anina whether they have had sight of the new little nano chameleon that was apparently just discovered yesterday. Is it in Mozambique?
Quite recently, yes. It's really tiny. And I think it was in Madagascar.
Yeah. Anyway, as you know, there is this Chameleon Project, and Morgan is very involved with that, with the Whale Coast Nature Reserve, where they've got the chameleon sanctuary. And it's lovely that Morgan is able to join us this morning and also share some computer knowledge with all of us old people. Welcome, Morgan. We look forward to hearing what you can tell us. And then, of course, a special welcome to Anina, Dr. Anina Lee. Anina received her education in Johannesburg, her schooling, and her university education was at WITS and the Iowa State University. And then her PhD in biochemistry came from WITS. She lectured in biochemistry at WITS for 12 years. And then while her children were at school, followed part-time work as a film and television actress and interior designer. Anina, I wasn't living in South Africa during those years, so I unfortunately missed out on the pleasure of seeing you on the screen.
It was no great loss, Patricia.
Lovely to see you now. Anina and her husband Robin moved to Hermanust in 2001. She immediately became involved. She joined the board of the then Overberg Conservation Foundation in 2002 and served on that committee for 12 years, five of which as chair. She's now the communications manager for Whale Coast Conservation and the chair of the Cliff Path Management Group. She writes a weekly column on environmental matters in the Village News and will publish a book collection of these articles later this year. We're really looking forward to seeing that on our shelves, Anina. It looks lovely. And then in 2019, Anina and Robin Lee received the Overstrand Mayor's Lifetime Award for Excellence for their service to the community. We're very proud of you, Robin and Anina, and we look forward to hearing what you've got to tell us this morning.
Thank you so much, Letitia, for that introduction. I've also been involved with U3A since its inception. In fact, I did a lot of the admin work for U3A in the early years, not to mention the technology, which was very challenging in those days. We live in an area of exceptional beauty, as looking at these photographs by Andrew Baxter will tell you. And so it's not out of the ordinary for me to go to this beautiful little poem, which I have edited a little bit with apologies. All things bright and beautiful, all creatures great and small, all things wise and wonderful, selection made them all. So that is my philosophy of life. And one of the most wonderful creatures in our area is this little guy, the Cape dwarf chameleon. He only occurs in the Western Cape and now increasingly less so. The Latin name, bradypodium, means slow foot, and pumilium means dwarf. Hence, little slow foot. These little chameleons still occur in the Hermanus area, in Greater Hermanus, specifically in the Onrus, Vermont to Houston area, but they are increasingly under threat from urban development. You will find them now in isolated patches, on undeveloped plots, and on roadsides. If you want to see one of these little chameleons, you just need to look at those tall restios, the thatching reed they like those best of all, even though those restios are not really indigenous to our area. So these little guys need our protection because they are no match for bulldozers. So Whale Coast Conservation started the Chameleon Project, in which Morgan has been involved for, well, since the inception of the project. And it's volunteers like Morgan, her mom, and the whole homeschoolers that enable us to run this project because it's very labor intensive. So this is just some photographs of the homeschoolers in action, showing us how to spot a chameleon. Well, you have to go out at night with a torch because the chameleons sleep at night. So they crawl up the vegetation to sleep away from the predators on the ground. And that's when you can spot them. Here's some more photographs of how we go about our project, which I won't go into in much detail, but here you can see Morgan with a chameleon specimen. Now this project depends on being able to find suitable spots to move chameleons when they need to be moved. And we only move them if it's absolutely critical and does not interfere with nature unless necessary. But it's very difficult to find suitable habitat. So we are busy with preparing a chameleon sanctuary on the Whale Coast Nature Reserve. And here you can see some of the home groups working to take out aliens to allow the natural fynbos to regenerate. And there's Morgan doing her bit again. These are the Horsten cadets who've also helped with alien removal. Now this project is very, very labor intensive, and it would be really nice to have funds to buy fynbos to more quickly regenerate the natural fynbos in the reserve. So we decided on publishing a book, and thank you, David, for taking it on. The book doesn't have a title yet, and if anyone can come up with a suitable title for the book, they will get a prize. They will get one of Margie's original illustrations for the book. So here we go with some of the stories from this book. Well, the book is a collection of 30 of the articles that have been published in the Village News. These articles, I started writing them in 2017 when there were only 20. The Village News was only published every 2 weeks then, leading up to last year when there were 51 articles, only missing out the week before Christmas and New Year when the newspaper was not published. And I assure you, it's not always easy to come up with a topic. And if anyone wants to send me topics to explore, you are very welcome. So it's all about Little Slowfoot, and the book is to raise funds for Little Slowfoot. Let's have a look at it. And if you can see these wonderful illustrations, that's what the book is about. They have stereoscopic eyes, which means the two eyes move independently of each other, and they can look at in different directions at the same time. So a chameleon can look over its shoulder to watch out for predators, or it can look forward, watching out for prey. They have a zygodactylous foot, which means that the toes are fused together into two claws, which act like a pincer so that it can more easily grab onto the branch on which it sits. The prehensile tail helps the chameleon to secure itself in the vegetation. The most interesting thing about Little Slowfoot is this missile tongue. The tongue shoots out at great speed. You must have seen it. You probably as a child went around with a chameleon on your finger hunting flies. And it can shoot out so quickly that the fly doesn't even have a chance to move. It shoots out much faster than can be achieved by muscle propulsion. So how does this happen? Well, the tongue is loaded with potential energy by a sphincter muscle that squeezes down on a sheath of collagen and it deforms that collagen, which is a protein. Now, when the muscle relaxes, that potential energy is released explosively, just like an arrow from a bow. And this allows the chameleon tongue to move so quickly. The end is very sticky. It's a very sticky saliva, which is 100 times more viscous than human saliva. Well, another interesting thing about little slowfoot is it's oviviviparous. In other words, it produces eggs, but the eggs are retained within the body until the development of the little embryos is complete. And then the chameleon gives birth to little, tiny little replicas of itself. There's no paternal or maternal care of their young. They're all on their own as soon as they are born. Now, we all think of chameleons as being green or largely green, and that they somehow change their color in response to the background on which they are. Well, chameleons do not, in fact, contain any green pigments. So how is that green color produced? Well, it's due to a coat of many layers, and I'm going to show you a little video in a while that explains exactly how all these layers work to produce the colors in a chameleon. And the chameleon doesn't change color to blend in with its background. It in fact changes color according to its mood, and it's more to stand out rather than blend in. And here's that little video, which I'm hoping is going to work for us, to show you just that.
There is a misconception about chameleons that they change their color in order to blend in with their environment. That is actually not the case. When a chameleon is calm, it is green, and so it naturally blends in with its leafy surroundings. But male chameleons change color when they become excited in the presence of a female or a rival male, as shown here. I'll put the first frame in the bottom right for comparison. As you can see, as he becomes more excited, his color changes to be more yellow, orange, and red. So instead of blending in, this chameleon will now stand out. But how do chameleons actually change their color? Well, for years, we thought that there was a simple, well-established mechanism for this color change. In their skin, chameleons have different cells containing colored pigments. Some are yellow, others are red, and some contain the dark melanin pigment. Many animals, including chameleons, are known to turn a darker shade by causing the melanin to spread out along the fingery extensions of the cell. They turn lighter again by condensing the pigment back into one spot. It was assumed that chameleons must turn yellow, orange, and red in the same way, by causing those pigments to spread out in those cells. But new research from collaborating groups of physicists and biologists at the University of Geneva shows that this is incorrect. Now, the first clue should come from the fact that there is actually no green pigment in a chameleon. The green color is actually created by two distinct mechanisms, pigment color and structural color. Beneath the yellow pigment cells, there are cells containing tiny 130 nanometer crystals regularly arranged in a lattice. Now, light diffracts off these crystals, and due to the spacing between them, blue light constructively interferes and is therefore strongly reflected, whereas the other colors are not reflected. This is very similar to how a morpho butterfly wing creates an iridescent blue. There is no blue pigment, just the periodic nanoscale structure that acts as a strong reflector for only one color. So a chameleon looks green due to the combination of the yellow light from the pigment plus the blue light reflected off the crystal structure beneath it. So how do chameleons change this green into yellow, orange, and red? Well, previously it was assumed that the color change was achieved by dispersing pigments in the colored cells, but now scientists have found it's actually the crystals underneath which are changing. By increasing the spacing between the crystals, the chameleons can change which color is selectively reflected. Bigger gaps between the crystals are better at reflecting longer wavelengths, so as the spacing increases, the color changes from blue to green to yellow, and then orange and red. Scientists compared skin samples from calm green chameleons and excited yellow chameleons and found that, indeed, in the excited chameleon, the crystal spacing was much further apart. Here you can see a single cell enlarged, and the color it reflects changing from blue to green to yellow, orange, and red. Plus, a computer simulation of the light reflected off crystals while their spacing is decreasing also provides excellent agreement with these observations. Furthermore, applying physical pressure to the skin causes the crystals to compress, and so they reflect more blue light. When that pressure is removed, the crystals expand again, reflecting more green light. The structure of a chameleon skin gets even more fascinating, as there's another layer of cells underneath which also contain crystals. But these crystals are larger, more spaced out, and more disorganized. This means they reflect longer wavelengths in the infrared part of the spectrum, and they reflect a broader range of these wavelengths. It's thought that the function of this layer could be to reflect heat from the sun, since these chameleons live in bright, full sun habitats. So male chameleons don't change their color hue by spreading out red and yellow pigments. Instead, they do something much more remarkable. They actively tune the spacing between nanoscale crystals in order to create structural colors that span the whole length of the visible spectrum. Now, what I find amazing is that in this day and age, we thought we had the answer to how chameleons change color, but it actually took the combined expertise of physicists and biologists working together to figure out what's really going on. This episode of Very...
Okay. This brings me to my next topic. Now, in most of my articles, I try to concentrate on, animals and species that we find in the Western Cape. But this little colorful fellow is such a firm favorite of mine that I've included it. Little peacock spiders that come from Australia. Now, these little spiders have been around a long time, but nobody ever noticed them because they are so tiny. They are like a grain of sand. And it was only when a man working for the Australian Department of Agriculture started investigating mites, agricultural mites, which are even smaller than peacock spiders. And in his research, he noticed these little spiders. And it is just amazing, the colors, the different colors. There are about 100 species now described. All of them have different colors. As you see, the males and the females are quite different, as you often find in birds. The males are brightly colored, the females less so. And the reason, obviously, is sexual selection. The brighter the male, the more likely he is to attract a female, or at least not be eaten by a female. And not only have they got these very bright colors, they've also evolved a little dance to impress the ladies, because they literally have to dance for their life. And here is a little video by Jürgen Otto. He's a peacock Spider-Man, and he put together this little video.
Thank you.
Right, so those little spiders literally dance to stay alive. So popular are these little peacock spiders that people are even making models of them with Lego. Now, it would be remiss of me if I didn't talk about fynbos. The fynbos biome is the most biodiverse in the whole world. And the center of this endemism is right here in the Kuchelberg. So we are living literally in paradise. Now it's interesting to think about how this biodiversity came about. But let's first have a look at this quote from Richard Cowling in his book on fynbos. At first glance, it appears incongruous. A botanical wonderland in an area where essential nutrients are very scarce, where summer drought dries out the topsoil for months, where recurring fires raise all in their path, where howling winds pummel ceaselessly for days, and where the amount of plant material produced is only marginally greater than in some deserts. These are definitely not the features that most people associate with paradise. So how come there's such great biodiversity under these adverse conditions? Well, it's all through selection of the adaptations that occur to adversity. Now, the main issue that they face is the extremely infertile soils. And they deal with adversity by forming relationships. So we have symbiotic relationships, meat-eating adaptations, and some are just plain parasites. So let's have a look at some examples here with these lovely illustrations by Margie. Bacteria form relationships with plants in the soil, and so do fungi. In the case of the proteas, the bacteria stimulate the proteas to produce dense clusters of rootlets, the so-called proteoid roots. These thick roots improve the uptake of poorly soluble nutrients. And they have another function also. The sponge-like roots will soak up water when it rains and then hold it and gradually release it when it's needed. And that's why some of our rivers keep flowing even in summer when there's no rain. So it's a very important ecosystem function that these proteas have. Bacteria also form relationships with pea flowers, the legumes like this Podalaria. They form little nodules on the roots of these plants, and the bacteria in the nodules have the ability to fix atmospheric nitrogen, and so that benefits both the bacteria and the plants. And then we have interactions with fungi. And that occurs mainly in the Erica species. And I've included this lovely painting by Margaret de Villiers of an Erica. So the fungal association takes the form of mycorrhizae. And these mycorrhizae also improve the ability of the plant to take up nutrients from the nutrient-poor soil. And in fact, about 75% of protea species have some sort of relationship with fungi. Then we get to the carnivores. These are the guys that have turned to eating meat to supplement their diet. This particular plant grows here in Fernkluf, right up there near Gulpenhut. It's called Rorigula gorgonis, and it is a kind of sundew. So it catches insects on these little, very viscous, sticky droplets. But this plant is unable to eat the insects itself, so it had to form a relationship with a little beetle, this little symbiotic carnivore, Pomeridia ruriguli. Now, this little beetle runs around on the plant. It does not get stuck in the stickiness on the plant, but it goes to eat the insects that the plant has caught for it. It digests those insects and defecates on the plant, and in that way, it fertilizes the plant. And in so close is the relationship between plant and beetle that the one cannot exist without the other. Then we have the parasites. These parasites grow on the roots of their host plants. They return nothing to the host plant except that they don't kill them. They take all their nourishment from the host plant, so they don't need to make leaves in order to photosynthesize, but they do need to make seeds to propagate themselves. So they produce quite spectacular flowers in order to attract the pollinators. Then we come to the fireflies. Fireflies are quite magical. And if you come with me on a firefly walk in October, you will be able to see them right here in Fernkloof. Now, fireflies are not flies, and they're not on fire, as you might imagine. They are insects, but they are beetles. And like all insects, they go through a whole life cycle, which we call metamorphosis. So the adult beetle will lay eggs in damp soil or leaf litter, always near water. So in Fernkloof, you will find them in areas where there's water. So those eggs develop quite quickly into a larva. And this is what the larva looks like. It looks like it's been like a little armored vehicle. And it lives there in the soil, and it's a voracious predator of anything slimy it can find in the undergrowth. So slugs and snails and worms are its prey. And it can take much larger prey than itself because it has a vicious bite, and it injects digestive enzymes into the prey, and then it turns the innards to mush, and then it slurps up the smoothie. That the larva, as is the case with most insect larvae, lives to eat. They are the part of the life cycle that's dedicated to eating. After the whole summer and winter in the soil, this larva will then pupate, and within about 3 weeks, the adult beetle will emerge. And that's when we see them flying around. Now, many insects have taken to being nocturnal, and specifically the fireflies, because during the day there are more predators around, so it's safer for them to fly around at night. But that has a problem built into it, because how do you find a mate? Because the adult firefly, as is the case with many adult insects, they are flighted and they are just concentrating on finding a mate and procreating. So how do you find a mate in the dark? Well, fireflies have evolved to produce their own light called bioluminescence. Bioluminescence is caused by a molecule called luciferin, and it varies from species to species. But the issue is that it uses energy from adenosine triphosphate. And that's the energy that that larva built up by all that eating, stored in the insect. And together with oxygen, it forms a reaction catalyzed by an enzyme called luciferase, and the outcome is a photon of light. In other words, in this process, the energy from ATP is converted to light energy. And that's what the insect uses to light its way at night. Okay, now how does it go about that? Well, the male insect is the one that looks out and goes around looking for a date. And he flies around flashing his little light. The female will sit lower on the ground or in the low vegetation. And if she sees a flash that she approves of, she will flash in reply, going, "Yoo-hoo, here I am." So the male will then approach her and try to mate with her. Now, different firefly species have different flash patterns. Because where fireflies occur in the same habitat, the different species have to be able to identify themselves, and they do this through the flash pattern. In the Western Cape, we only have one species of firefly, Luciola capensis, and it is tiny. It's the size of a grain of rice, and you wonder how on earth can that little bug produce all that light, because a photon of light is the same energy, whatever the size of the insect that produces it. So these little guys, their energy doesn't last long. In fact, it's like a little battery that runs down as they use up all their ATP, and they have no way of recharging their batteries because the adults don't eat. So their flashing lasts about half an hour only, and if they don't find a mate in that time, they lose out. So the female, when she flashes back, she can attract more than one male because there always seem to be a lot more males around than females. And how does she now decide which mate to accept? Because she only mates with one male once. So she has to decide who's going to be the best partner for her. And she does that through evaluating the nuptial gift. The male firefly has to present her with a gift. It's called a spermatophore, and it contains sperm and some nutritious proteins that enable the female to produce more eggs. So when it comes to mating, the female firefly seems to prefer substance over flashiness. So many people behave like that also. Now I have there's a truism that I believe in, and that is whatever exists in nature, something will evolve to eat it. And this is a way of nature staying in balance with itself. In other words, predator and prey stay in balance. So let's look at the case of the Cigalaria africana, the wild peach tree. This tree has evolved over time to protect itself from predation by producing a kind of cyanide in its leaves. So one would think that that would be pretty good protection, but not so. Whatever exists, something will evolve to eat it. And here we have a clue about that. There's something that has evolved. And what is it? It's this. It's the garden acria butterfly. The larva of that butterfly, the caterpillar, has evolved to deal with the cyanide by sequestering the poison in these little protuberances from its skin. So it removes the poison from its own body, its own metabolism, and loads it into the skin. Now this makes the caterpillar poisonous as well, and it protects it in turn from its predators. And when the caterpillar pupates and turns into a butterfly, the butterfly is also toxic, and this toxicity is advertised by the bright colors of the butterfly. Now, what has evolved to eat this poisonous little creature? Well, it is a cuckoo, specifically classed as cuckoo. This cuckoo has learned how to deal with that acrid insect by bashing it on a branch of the tree until all the innards splat out, and then it only eats the innards and leaves the poisonous skin behind. So there we have another balance between prey and predator. And this is what keeps balance in nature. And then it leaves me to ponder, what is going to evolve to eat Homo sapiens? Will it be a virus? So this brings me now to this. I'm sure everybody has seen these little pits in the sand. You may even have gone with a little stick and stirred up the bottom of the pit to see what lies beneath. It is in fact an antlion. And this antlion is also an insect. And the antlion, as we call it, is the larval form of the antlion insect. It has evolved a very specific and sophisticated way of catching its prey. It digs this little pit, and anything that falls into it will fall down to the bottom, because the pit is so designed that the sand is on the point of avalanching down, and any disturbance, any insect that falls in that pit will avalanche down with the sand, and there below is lurking this rather monstrous creature with mandibles that are designed to catch that prey. It also injects digestive enzymes into the prey and sucks out the juices, and then it discards the empty shell. Let's have a look how that happens.
A sandy wasteland. Its savage ruler lies hidden beneath the sand. Its presence revealed only by catapulted corpses, the grisly remains of discarded victims, empty shells of insects murdered and tossed aside. But by what? By this, the antlion, the spawn of the netherworld. This is its lair. Digging backwards in the sand, the antlion creates a funnel-shaped burrow. Then it buries itself to lie in wait for its next victim. The ants have no idea that a trap lies below. A firebug loses its grip on the sand and slips down the funnel into waiting jaws. Once he pulls his catch into the sand, the antlion injects it with poison and digestive enzymes and sucks out its liquefied guts. Then it throws the empty bug shell up, up, and away. If the victims don't slide down on their own, the antlion launches an assault. Struggling only makes matters worse. Finally, the assassin reaches up to make the kill, injecting its toxic cocktail. Resistance is futile. Once you've fallen into the lion's den, there's only one way for this horror story to end.
And what does the adult antlion look like? Well, it's not nearly as horrific as the larva. It's a lacewing. And a lacewing, while it resembles a dragonfly, you can tell the difference by these antennae. The lacewing has little club-like antennae, and the eyes on the two sides do not meet in the middle. In a dragonfly, the two compound eyes actually meet on top of the head, and that's how you can tell the difference. So, the next question I have to ask you at the end of my presentation is, how can you help our chameleons? So you can support Whale Coast Conservation. You can buy the book when it is published, and you can even pre-order your copies from Footprint Press. And you could buy one of Margie's original illustrations. These will all go towards funding our chameleon project. And I thank you for listening. And I'd like to extend my special thanks to Margie Crossman for her wonderful illustrations, to the Village News, who published the articles in the first place, and the AVI Community Trust that has supported the production of this book. So thank you very much. And at this stage, I would like to introduce Morgan Hendricks. Now, Morgan was one of our Wailcoast Conservation staunchest supporters. She has been a supporter and involved with Wailcoast Conservation for many years, and Morgan can tell us how many years it's been, but since she was a little girl, she's now 14 and still a very valuable volunteer for the Chameleon Project, because we cannot do that project without volunteers. We need people on the ground to first of all monitor where the chameleons are, and secondly, if they are in any danger, we need to make plans to relocate them. So, Morgan, can you tell us a little bit about your involvement in the Chameleon Project and a little bit about chameleons themselves?
All right. Hello, everybody. Good morning, and thank you for tuning in to the Zoom stream. My name is Morgan, and I'm a homeschooler, just to tell you a little bit about me. In this project, I've been teaming up with other homeschoolers as well, and thank you for this opportunity to share our experience. Before I continue, I just want to share a big thank you to Auntie Anina and Margie Crossman and all the other WCC members for their care and for their effort and insight. I recently heard a quote from Dr. Zeus in his book, The Lorax. And this quote really inspires me because I can liken it to Auntie Anina and her work. It says, unless someone like you cares a whole awful lot, nothing's going to get better. It's not. Thank you, Auntie Anina, for teaching me this. So how did this all start? Me and my mum attended WCC talks, and we also began to go to the activities, the environmental activities. That was in 2015, but later in 2017, we were called to come and help in the searches for the chameleons, which happened at night. And how did this actually all start, this whole searches at night? Well, it actually started with a lady called Daphne Bayers, a wonderful lady. She's from Fisher Haven, and she alerted the Wailcoast Conservation Organization about the presence of chameleons in Fisher Haven. Eventually, the searches progressed to what it is now. It progressed from Fisher Haven to Vermont and right through, as the project's been going on, to Falkirk. And not only were all the searches extremely fascinating, but they were also vital. Did you know that the chameleon is only found, the Cape Dwarf chameleon, sorry, is only found in the southwest Cape region, which would be from Cape Town to De Hoop. And just like the endemic fynbos, its creatures are special too. And I'll tell you why the Cape Dwarf chameleon is special. So its scientific name is Bradypodium prunellum, as Auntie Anina mentioned. And Bradypodium means slowfoot, and prunellum is dwarf. So its actual name is Little Slowfoot. And the name suggests its features, and its features are quite slow. And that makes them vulnerable. And I realized this, that even though they are very beautiful creatures, that they are extremely vulnerable, and their natural predators, this was one of the questions in the chat, I'm about to answer it now, is that their natural predators are birds like Fiscal Shrike, Franklin, what's that other one? Helmeted Guinea Fowl, there we go. But it is absolutely no match for bulldozers. And as we continued in our searches, we noticed that as Hermanus was expanding, the bulldozing was coming closer and closer to where the chameleons were living. let's take another example here. In Vermont, which is the suburb in Hermanus where we've most of our searches have been done, there are lots of open plots. And in those plots, you have a variety of different fynbos, which is very good for the chameleons to live in. But not only that, you also have plots which are very closely situated to each other. And that creates a corridor for the chameleons to move through. And as the housing development happens, these corridors get blocked off one by one by each of the plots that are being developed. And that led the chameleon monitors, the people who work in the in the project, to go for the solution of rescue and relocation. So in total, in 2019, 515 chameleons were accounted for, and 167 of those chameleons were relocated. But we noticed that as we were relocating, there were less and less plots available for relocation. So we were faced with another problem because there were just less and less all the time. That is why today's episode is how to create a chameleon sanctuary. Excuse me, guys, that was Suzelle DIY chipping in. That is why recently we have been, the chameleon project has been focusing our efforts on building a chameleon sanctuary. So how are we doing this? We are removing alien invasive plants like Port Jackson, Australian myrtle, there's also Rooikrans, and we are wanting to replace those plants with restios, which we find chameleons on. And this is going to be happening in a section of the Whale Coast Nature Reserve, which is just opposite the greenhouse. And this is where we are focusing the chameleon project today. Although our current night searches are still continuing, but that is according to the communications we have with the municipality, because they let us know when and where they are going to do a necessary burn. And we would like to rescue the chameleons out of harm's way and place them in a safer place. Just something that I found quite amusing, that as a group, we've learnt that we must alert the law enforcement in the area that we're about to search. Because the residents have often been concerned that there have been UFOs landing in their back. Oh, no, I'm joking. It's a bit shocking when you see a torchlight shining through and you wonder if there's any criminal activity. So it's always necessary to alert the law enforcement. And since then, we've always had quite our searches have been quite secure and safe. So what are the highlights of these searches and the whole chameleon project? There are many highlights, but I have just focused on two that are really important to me. The first highlight, let's just notice that I really enjoy artwork. Margie Crossman is a big inspiration. I enjoy art. I like drawing and sketching and painting. But I also like the chameleon project. And I like how that in many different ways, artists have expressed their concern and their concern for the chameleon project in their art. In many different forms of art as well. We had Lego at the Fynbos Festival. There was some music, but also at one event, there was the art walk in Walker Bay, where artists displayed their works on the theme of chameleons. And that was really special for me, because it showed me that people are caring and people are encouraging us to continue with this work. And that's encouraging for me. Highlight number two is the people who have joined us throughout this project. We've had the homeschoolers, we've had the Horsten cadets, we've had a couple of public schoolers join us. We've had volunteers from other organizations to come and see what we've been doing. There's even the odd holiday maker. Even though it was just a once off, but it was very amusing to have them come and do a bit of conservation work with us. But my point is that each and every one of them always gave positive feedback of the unforgettable experience. And as a young person, and just starting in this, just beginning in this conservation work, that is the one thing that struck me about never losing the awe and wonder of what's around you in your natural environment. And that's important to me. It's going to affect me for the rest of my life in conservation work. To never lose the awe and the wonder of all things bright and beautiful. Thank you for listening to this talk. Hope we get to see you again. I'm going to hand over back to Auntie Anina, if I'm correct. Yeah, or Letitia Snowman.
Morgan, thank you very, very much. As a retired school principal, I am so proud of youngsters like you. Thank you for coming to share with us your enjoyment. And Anina, the enthusiasm that you have sparked is just amazing. And I'm particularly moved by the emphasis on retaining one's awe for the wonders of nature. Thank you for what you do.
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you, Letitia. There's one comment by Robin. He asked me to tell you more about the book contents. Well, this book is a compilation of 30 of the articles that I've written over the 4 years. And obviously I've chosen the ones that I like best, and Margie has managed to illustrate all of them really beautifully. The book will be published by Footprint Press probably fairly soon. Maybe David can tell us more about the timeline, but you will be informed about its publication in due course. You will even be able to order pre-publication copies, because we are only printing a limited number. So if you would like to support the project or have the book, please make a point of buying it, and you will be informed via the media, both our social media and obviously through the village news.
Thank you, Anina. I see Margie has been with us throughout this presentation. Margie, what you've been getting on with when I haven't been keeping an eye on you is amazing. I'm so looking forward to this book, and thank you for joining the presentation this morning. A welcome to all the people from the Botanical Society and Wild Coast Conservation. Lovely to have you able to join us. And I see Don there, all the way from England. He normally would be here as a swallow, but now you're stuck in cold London. South in England. But thank you to all of you. Now, there are several questions, Anina. Can you see them on the chat show? I know Ed wanted to know what the predators for chameleons are. That was the first question, and I think there are a few others.
Yes. Thanks. I can't see all of them, but you can feed them to me. The main predators, as Morgan mentioned, are birds like fiscal shrikes, and now increasingly crows that are moving into our area. And in the urban areas, of course, domestic cats are very active predators. So they do have a little problem there with domestic cats. But there's actually quite a high attrition rate in chameleons. Their survival rate is not great, and the chameleons have adapted to that fact by producing several litters of babies in a year. So they breed all year round, not just once a year like birds do.
Anina, according to African mythology, chameleons are not very popular. There is the myth about them being too slow to bring the message of eternal life from the creator, and they were beaten to it, so we all unfortunately have to die. and I am having grown up in the north, you're aware of the fact that chameleons are, they're scared of them and they not very welcoming. Is any of that prevalent down in this area?
Not that I've noticed, Letitia. I do know that many indigenous people are afraid of chameleons. It may have something to do, as you say, with that legend or myth, something to do with the fact that they're so brightly colored, which often indicates that an animal is poisonous or toxic.
Yeah.
So that could be also it. And I mean, they look like little dragons, so people might be afraid of them. But we've not experienced it in our project at all, possibly because there are no chameleons in the townships. Where we do find them in Horston, for example, people are very attuned to chameleons. And certainly anyone who sees a chameleon in their garden is so excited about that. They remember as children seeing many more of them, and they're really excited to find any now. And of course, if you have chameleons in your garden, it means that you have a very bio-friendly garden, and therefore you should be very proud.
Anina, just a question.
John?
John. Anina, why would you also not use Fern Kloof as a further preservation or reserve area for them? I mean, it's great that you've identified a whole new area across the road from the greenhouse, but you know, if you had a fire there, do you spread your risk and also have a place in Fern Kloof for them?
Yeah, John, there are several reasons for that. We have used parts of Fern Kloof along the Mossel River to release some of our chameleons, but they are more a lowland species. You don't see many up the mountains. You do in fact see quite a lot of chameleons on the cliff path if you but look. And so they're more lowland, and so the Fern Kloof Nature Reserve is really a mountainous reserve. And there are also already existing populations of chameleons there, although not many. The lower part of the nature reserve, I think Morgan and her team have seen chameleons along the edge, that lower portion where the bypass road is supposed to go. So yeah, you can't move chameleons into an area where there are already resident chameleons. So because it stresses both groups of chameleons. And then secondly, you have to ask yourself, if there aren't any chameleons there, why not? Is it not suitable for chameleons? So that's the dilemma.
Okay, fantastic.
So they are territorial. They would be unhappy to have someone pick up a chameleon and go and put it in.
Yeah, very, very territorial. And they get very unhappy if a strange, especially a strange male, would come into their territory.
Mm. I'm very, very impressed with the male dancing show and the video of your spiders. And see what we made of.
Yeah, it's a very interesting balance between sexual selection, which would select for the animal with the brightest colors, which incidentally are also produced by iridescence, and the balance with natural selection, which would mean that you are less visible to your predators. So there is a trade-off between natural selection to not be so brightly colored and sexual selection, which makes you more colorful to make you more appealing to the female. So a peacock spider would apparently rather die by predation than be rejected by a female.
Great.
Lesson there.
Yeah, my question.
Ed, you wanted to ask something?
Yes, my question to Anina is, do chameleons have a bone structure? And would one be able to see those bones undigested coming through in the regurgitated pellets of owls?
Yes, indeed. They are vertebrates. They do certainly have a bony skeleton. And if owls were to take them, I'm sure you would see it in the owl pellets. So yes, indeed. And in fact, if you look closely at a chameleon, you can mostly see its ribs sticking through the skin. if you see a chameleon, you can usually tell the gender of the chameleon because females are rounder, say more rounded than the males, which are very slim and long.
Thank you. I might just make a comment that outside of our fence, we're on the Ferncliff Nature Reserve. And as you well know, we released quite a number, 20 or more dwarf chameleons. And I was doing counts at one stage, and I've been disappointed that recently I haven't seen any. But I have some very active owls, and this is my concern that the owls might be predating on our dear little chameleons.
Oh my, you mean we've been feeding the owls?
That could be. Could be. I'll bring you some sample pellets to look at, and we can try and work it out.
The problem with releasing chameleons into an area such as the Mossel River flood plain is that the vegetation there is so thick that it's extremely difficult to find them again. So we actually don't have an accurate impression of how many of those chameleons have survived. They move, they do move quite long distances, and they're not going to stay around where you can find them again easily.
Thank you.
Anina, I think we've just about come to the end, unless there are some urgent additional questions. Thank you very much. We always, always appreciate your presentations to U3A, and it's again been an absolute delight this morning, and I'm glad that we can involve the other groups that you are so closely associated with. And Morgan, once again, it was absolutely super to have you join us, and good luck with the rest of your schooling, and you sound like a very busy girl who's going to go a very, very long way. And Auntie Anina will, I hope, continue to inspire you. Thank you very much. Thank you to all of you for joining in. And Henny, thank you for hosting this absolutely splendid presentation. Thank you, Anina.
Thank you. My pleasure. Thank you, Letitia. Bye.